Just because I'm telling you this story doesn't mean I'm alive at the end of it. It's that kind of a story where things just got so out of control. Every successful business has an origin. Ben went to Berkeley and double majored in business and botany.
This is the best cannabis in the world.
I think we just struck gold.
He takes 99% of the violence out of the business. The other 1%? Well, that's where Tron comes in.
You guys, you have a clean business.
But now when cartels are moving north, they want a Ben and Tron section in aisle 3.
I love you guys.
So three of us now.
And yes, I'm with both of them.
Okay, when they say the name of this movie is Savages, they're not lying. Take this title for what it says. I came out this movie feeling just hopeless.
Well, you should.
Because
this was Taylor Kitsch's last shot.
No, you have summer. To understand. This is an Oliver Stone movie, Leon. The Savages are us.
Oh, wait. What?
Well, you didn't think he was going to make a movie about the drug war and really give a shit about the actual plot other than as a metaphor for something else, did you?
Uh-oh.
No, I was...
I don't like the sound of this at
it's
all.
It's Oliver Stone. What'd you think was going to happen?
I came out just feeling... I felt dirty. I felt worthless. I kind of felt like... This is a movie where you have two guys who are going to save their girlfriend, which they share... And they love it that much that they say, fuck, I'm going up against the cartel who took her. I'm like,
man, if the cartel took my mama, I'd be like, hey, she had a lot of good years.
This is the Ripley cat situation all over again.
Right.
Where I love cats, but fuck that cat.
I thought it was pretty much Oliver Stone going, hey, fuck you, Tony Scott. I can do what you can do.
Oh, see, that was what I was afraid of. Watch a trailer. I was like, well, okay, it doesn't have Tony Scott's name on it, so maybe it won't be one of those.
I don't know if it was as bad as that. I mean, certainly Oliver Stone has been playing around with this sort of like lots of different filters thing before Tony Scott.
Yeah, I agree with you there. But you do have a point, though. If somebody kidnapped my mom and they said, hey,
it was a cartel,
called me, they said, hey, you need to mail us $10-$15 today, I'd be like, hey, you can keep her. But then again, I'm not fucking my mother either. Yeah, I mean, this girl was like really good.
Here's the money and you can keep her. Just don't fuck with me.
What
do I have to do to make you happy?
I mean, but here's the deal. You're thinking, because you're going in and the trailer shows you these guys are sharing this hot blonde and they're growing some really mellow weed. And then they decide to go up against the cartel and you're thinking it's for righteous reasons. And in their minds, it is. You have Taylor Kitsch. And who's the guy that was in... Aaron Taylor Johnson, the guy that was in Kick-Ass. He was Kick-Ass.
Right.
Oh,
right.
Yeah. That's right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. They played two friends. They couldn't be from the farthest end of the spectrum.
They're gay.
Think Hawk
and Dove.
One guy is a Buddhist.
Thank you for breaking it down on comic book terms.
Yeah, no. One guy's a Buddhist. The other guy is an ex-Navy SEAL.
Oh,
who,
Jesus. Okay.
I mean,
and they're both gay.
Yeah, no.
Not gay. Relax.
And they're both having sex with this girl named Ophelia, played by Blake Lively.
I like talking to you, Ophelia. But let me remind you that if I had to, I wouldn't have a problem cutting both their throats.
Well, you'll never get them together. I'm the only one who can do that.
Come on. Are you really bragging about that? There's something wrong with your love story, baby. They may love you, but they will never love you as much as they love each other. Otherwise, they wouldn't share you, would they?
And she says, why am I in this? Because, well, Ben, who's a Buddhist, when he has sex with me, he makes love. When this other guy has sex with me, he fucks me. I mean, he fucks to just he has flashbacks to the war when he's having sex with her. I mean, he's like, check this.
She so cleverly says that he has a wargasm. Get
yeah.
it?
Yeah.
Oh my god. Every bit of her voiceover narration, they always have like bad puns in there, and like I have never seen a theatrical like a press screening audience so not respond to jokes before.
Oh, yeah.
It's with those. It's like one of those. Literally, there was silence. Someone went. Yeah.
I was wondering why Cyrus was dealing with laughing.
I wasn't laughing.
It is funny. I mean, this guy has. It's like he's so. I mean, you can tell he's violent because he just has hardly any emotion. He just jumps at everything. There's a part where he's having sex with her and he hears a gun go off. Actually, it's a car kicking back, but nevertheless, he hides in her vagina at that point.
All in that thing.
Yeah, all of, you see two eyes sticking out. Are they gone? It's okay. No, but. The thing that they have, you say, well, what do these guys really have in common besides this girl and probably years of history as friends? Well, they grow the best weed, apparently, in the world.
Well, yeah, they're, according to the movie, they're running basically the best pot world business out of California at this point in time.
Oh, so it's breaking
bad weed. Their THC's levels are through the roof.
Yes, as they say in the movie. Yeah, they're
33%
doing, and they're doing this in Laguna Beach. But so... I mean, when you run a business like this and you have such a high reputation, it's only a matter of time before somebody is going to want to cut in on it. And it's the cartel that comes in. And I mean, they don't. I like the way the cartel sends you like an Evite. They Evite shows severed heads all over the floor, then playing kickball with it and everything. And then they send you a nice email saying, hey, let's meet and talk business.
Haven't you ever seen the cartel's YouTube page? It's through the roof. They got subscribers out the ass, dude.
There's like 30,000 likes. Yeah.
I'm surprised they're not reviewing movies at this point.
Yeah.
Not for nothing. You guys might want to work on your marketing strategy.
Yeah, you know, but I tell you, for me, that would work. And they come in, and this is one of my biggest...
So listen up, cartel. If you want to own Spill, just send us one of those messages.
Yeah. Yeah. If you want a piece of this, please.
Next time we get together, he's going to be some quiet, big Mexican dude sitting behind you the whole time. Who's that guy? Yeah. Never mind. He's just calm boss. Right. Hey,
it ain't going to be me.
It's Poco. Say hello, Poco. But no, this is one of my problems with the movie, is that... Now... Let's just take the severed heads video that they sent on the Evite. They sit down and they're actually nice businessmen at first. They say, listen, you guys are the best at what you do. And they really are nice. I mean, a nice hotel, they got on suits. We want to cut in on the business with you. We're not going to kill you. If you come in, join us on the business, show us how you make such great kush, and you're going to see your business.
Triple,
in 3 years,
you're gonna make a lot more.
You're gonna be,
wait, how many times can we say through the roof?
No, I mean, they say, look, you'll be rolling in, pretty much three times the millions that you have right now. It really doesn't seem like a bad proposition at all.
The thing, though, is that the Taylor Kitsch character, who's seen a lot of warfare, who's familiar with the ugly underbelly of crime already, supposedly, because he's been the enforcer of the two guys while they built up this business, is like, no, dude, they are not going to keep the word on this. These guys are going to fuck us. There's no good side to this. Don't believe anything they say. And to be fair, he's probably right.
Sure. Yeah. See, that's what
he is right. He's
you know what, Coles? I'm going to let you go real quick because I just want to say one of the things that it's an ugly movie. And what I can give it credit for, it really has me at odds because Taylor Kitsch, I mean, he's so cold because he's seen a lot. And you get mad because they resort to the same level of violence as the cartels. And you see the good guys doing those ugly things. And it takes away that whole feeling of a revenge fantasy, like cheering the good guys on.
Yeah.
I mean, you think to yourself, man, if I was in a revenge fantasy, I could never probably carry it out because I couldn't sink to the levels that these guys do. And you have to think to yourself, man, but at the same time, they're doing this violence to these people who have probably done worse. And just because I haven't seen them do it doesn't mean that maybe they don't deserve it. I was really at emotional odds with this movie. I was fucked up when I walked out of it.
Because Oliver Stone has forgotten to be a regular storyteller anymore, and now he just wants to tell his other story, which is the overlying thing. And there was a point about halfway through this film when I had already kind of given up on it. I was like, man, I just don't... None of these guys, they're not very likable. It's not very believable. It's full of, like, stylish flourishes that are just kind of yawn-inducing at this point in time. Like, nothing new. When I suddenly went, oh, wait, I totally see what he's doing here. And I'm not saying that it's a good thing, but I started to have fun with it only in the context of trying to figure out who each character in the film represented to Oliver Stone in the context of talking about the drug war, which is really what his intent is with this film.
It seemed like a tamer version of, let's say, a Natural Born Killers, which I guess it seemed like he was trying to give you characters that normally you probably wouldn't like. I mean, you still, despite the fact that they're a bunch of, you know, you got one hippie and you got the Punisher working together. I mean, they really had to, like, They really had to like sell to you like, why should you even care about these guys?
Yeah.
Why should you give two shits about the Devil's Threesome that all they do is, you know, they're taking baths every day. They're living like stoners with a shitload of money. So, I mean, I was trying to find, okay, at what point do I really want to care about what's going on here to begin with? I'm like, you know, they all done something stupid to the fact that, yeah, shit's going to happen when you're fucking with the cartel. No duh. But my biggest problem, though, with this movie is that, you know, it's being told from the perspective of a pothead. And watching the movie, I felt like a pothead was telling me a story. And sometimes with potheads, their story goes on and on and on when you ask, so what's the point of this? And even the storyteller's like, you know what? I don't know.
What was he talking about? Well, you know, like, on that note, one of the most irritating cinematic tricks he does early on, like the first lines out of this movie where you're like, oh, is there going to be a narrator? Fuck. And it's what's her name?
Blake Lively.
Blake Lively. Yeah.
Going, I'm not going to tell you that I survived till the end of this film. I mean, I'm not telling you I don't either. And that whole thing, like, so great. You're going to make us spend this whole film going like, why did you even bring that up?
Which is lazy. It's the director trying to make you feel already like, okay, I gotta stay invested in this because he's gonna give me something that I'm not expecting.
But once again, it creates a sense of unreality to the film, which is ultimately what he wants the audience to get out of it. Does it work? Probably not on the whole, but I thought it was kind of entertaining. Yeah.
Can I ask you something? What is it? What part, what different characters did you think represented what part of the drug war?
Because I mean, there's only so much I can say without giving away the entire end of the film, which is where it's like, oh, well, there's a no question now what he's talking about. But I mean, like, everybody in there is like, I mean, obviously John Travolta represents sort of like the feds or the CIA or
in the movie, like, he plays a crooked DEA agent.
Yeah, the American part of a, like, illegal involvement with drug operations and how they have a hand in everybody's business and just play one side out of the off the other in order to profit.
You
got the two main guys are basically the right wing and the left wing, with your average American right there in the middle, and that pre-drug war America more pleasant relationship. And then as the drug war comes into it and it starts to go, wow, everybody stands a chance to make money off of this. Everything starts to change with that relationship, with their motivations, with the way they are towards the rest of the world.
Yeah.
I mean, and everybody in here to some degree or another represents some part of that.
Yeah.
And I was actually kind of having fun trying to decipher that. But the problem is it was at the sacrifice of the story itself and of these characters. Ultimately, to watch it on just a level of, hey, I want to watch a fun movie, that more and more slipped away as the movie was going on.
Yeah, you know, I will say, though, that the thing that really carried me through the movie, if I didn't like the characters, I liked the actors that are portraying some of these characters. John Travolta, we just mentioned, as a crooked DEA agent, he's great. He's not in the movie that much, but he's so quick in his dialogue delivery. It's like watching that John Travolta predating Pulp Fiction.
You know? Oh,
yeah,
really?
I mean, because he's
the way you described him, he sounds more like the God damn it, was it Chili Palmer? Get Shorty.
He's a little more lively than that. This what I'm saying is that this is the most lively that I've seen John Travolta in years.
Yeah,
it's almost
he
like people
been
have wanted him to be too cool for some movies. In this one, I mean, it's good to see him. Whenever I've seen John Travolta play this kind of character, it's usually been in bad movies.
Right.
And this one, I don't think is necessarily a bad film. Selma Hayek is the head of this drug cartel. And she's just having fun with her role. You can tell that. But Benicio del Toro I think he's a great character in this. And it works because he's a villain. But he's one of those villains that I really like because, again, I'm torn on how to feel about this guy. He does these horrible things to people. I mean, he's a cartel enforcer. But then Benicio del Toro is so good in this role. And he's funny. I mean, he's really funny. He's like, he's just like those no bullshit guys who you can tell they never had too much education, but they're very smart and they're tough enough to like let you know, look, I'm smart enough to know that you're trying to fuck me over, and I'm not going to have it. I'll beat your ass if you try to do anything otherwise.
He's obviously having fun. He's the one actor in this whole thing that was actually keeping me interested. You know, Selma Hayek was good, but Benicio del Toro, for a little while, when I was watching him, I was like, all right, dude, what in the fuck are you doing? What are you trying to do with this character? Are you playing him up to be silly? But when I realized, oh, this guy's supposed to be fucked up, and you know what? He's playing a great fucked up because he's making me kind of squirm watching him, you know, watching Benicio Del Toro play this character. He does make you squirm in a lot of scenes in this. But, I mean, that's the aspect that he's almost playing such a caricature of what people probably think the cartel is.
Well, yeah.
That it's fun.
Well, and I mean, if there's one problem, it's not with him in and of itself, because you're right, Benicio Del Toro, who chews up the scenery, he is evil to the point that he's likably evil. And I felt like they almost went back and added stuff to make him where he goes past that, because Stone was like, shit, audiences are coming out of this liking his character, and that's not what you're actually supposed to get. And so they add, like, there's a scene where he shows this Blake Lively something on a cell phone that was like, why in the fuck would you even add that in there? Why? What was the point of that?
Yeah,
it was just like disturbing and like, okay, why? What did that add to the story?
Yeah, it's almost like that I'm curious about, because when I looked at the trailer, like Selma Hayek was like way over the top, to where I was like, I might have trouble believing.
She's having fun, but like I think once again, like I think that the relationship between her and Benicio Del Toro also has something to do with the stuff, that overlying metaphor, what they're trying to say. Not to go too deep into that, because I can't quite. Frankly,
because the thing is that those two are the most interesting. Because I caught myself not really caring about the main characters anymore. I was more interested in just watching Benicio Del Toro and Salma Hayek just interact.
Yeah, but they were much more interesting.
Yeah, they were far more interesting, where the story just, I was like, all right, you know, but I was like, okay, get me reinvested in this whole plot, because the plot seems so drawn out for how simple it was, you know, that when you really get to the end, you're like, it felt like I was missing a big part of the story, or it really didn't have that fitting ending.
Tell you the reason why
for.
Because they spend too much time on your main characters, who, as I said, as we start to just as they become more dehumanized, that's how they feel, more dehumanized as characters. I mean, Taylor Kitsch, again, not doing a bad acting job, just his character is so cold to where he has no emotions throughout any of the movie. So,
and we're also supposed to believe that these guys who stay stoned 24 hours a day have this huge, elaborate, like, con, basically, that they're pulling on a major cartel with practically zero effort. You know, I mean, they're almost Ocean 11.
They pull some CSI shit. Yeah, they really do. And as compared to, I mean, you look at these guys and you just kind of get frustrated with them because they start to do evil things, but you really don't, since you don't care about them, you just start to take them as, all right, you're becoming just as evil as the cartel. At least that's the way I felt. I just didn't feel anything for them. I disliked them very much. As opposed to when Benicio Del Toro walked in a room, I've had a reaction. He would come in, and you start to like hold your breath, because I'm like, oh shit, is he gonna cut somebody, shoot somebody? And then he makes a joke, you're like, oh shit, you know. And even then, you're just kind of like,
it's that threat, though. I think that's the problem we have with the main characters. Is like, they really don't know how serious of a threat this is to them, their well being, just for them doing what they do. Because the moment that they had that scene where they're watching on their computer, like, you see about 10 guys in a room that got their heads decapitated by a chainsaw, their reaction to it is just kind of like, okay, I'm not worried about that. Why should I be worried? Yeah. Well,
actually, Taylor Kitsch had that look that he's beginning to have in every movie. He's turning to Mark Wahlberg with an angry look. I didn't think anybody could out anger Mark Wahlberg, but he really getting that angry.
What are we gonna do, man? I don't know.
Yeah, you know that angry, confused look.
Kick-Ass is a little more pulled back though. He's like, I don't want that shit. Let's just give him the business.
And he actually was like, you do relate to him at first.
Like the most, probably maybe even the most liberal out of all of us are left wing, and even I was like, fuck that shit, you're not giving them anything, that's your business, you stand by that.
But that scene that establishes where it's just not that big of a threat, I was like, okay, how powerful is that fucking weed that you're smoking? Even Blake Lively, she's like, you know what, guys, let's just hide here in the house, you know, let's just be together, hide here in the house, and you know, we'll be all right. And I'm just like, okay, well, man, stop smoking the fucking weed and get the fuck out of the country already.
Yeah, you know, I will say, though, that Oliver Stone he's become too stylistic now. Yeah. I mean, I agree, he's not a Tony Scott, but he does do that thing that we've seen him do in movies that don't need it. And I don't think this movie needs that. To a certain level, it works. I mean, there's some visual tricks because this is more of an action film. So certain things that he does, you let it go and you say, okay, this adds to what fun there is to be had in this movie. Visually, there's a lot of fun in it. But then he just, I don't know what he's trying to do. There's certain things where he wants to give you a premonition of something, so the screen just goes black and white for no reason. And plus, speaking of that stylistic thing he has going on.
He just got
on,
a new filter package.
Yeah, that's what it feels like. He's playing with like a fucking, you know, he's with After Effects a little bit too much.
Did you notice all the flares in the movie that came out of nowhere?
Out of nowhere.
I was reading in Variety how he's getting sued by J.J. Abrams for that.
But no, not lens flare. He actually
actual flare.
He brings out a flare.
Oh, you mean like little buttons?
Like it's a, like
suspenders. No, I mean like road flares.
Yeah, like a birthday cake with road flare on it.
I've kept waiting to see the Enterprise fucking pull up out of nowhere.
But I don't want to ruin anything, man. But I mean, he's getting even the violence in this. It goes from horrible to, hey, is this kind of being silly now? I don't know if this is comedic or what. I mean,
it can't stick to the same tone at any point in this film. And a lot of people, I think, will compare it to some degree to Natural Born Killers because of both that, which Natural Born Killers most certainly did, and also the constant changing of filters. But both those things made sense in the context of Natural Born Killers.
Well, I just want to tell you real quick. I just want to say to tell you about how crazy they get with the violence. That somebody gets there, they get an ass whooping. I mean, I'm talking about like with a belt. Well, they use a whip in this, but you know, he's getting the ass whooping so bad that eyeball comes out. And I'm just like, shit. And I thought my mama beat my ass when I was a kid. But that's when I looked at it, I was like, that's something that's a little extreme. I mean, we get the point.
Well, it's because it does. It feels like it has to gross you out. I mean, it points the violence. There's a couple scenes of the violence is fun. Like, there's a big action scene that's really cool in here. I was like, whoa, woke me up, where it's like them taking out a whole, like, mob cartel shipment. It's like, wow, this is actually really fucking cool. But then most of the time, the violence in it is just that. It's like, oh, we want to see how far we can push this to where you're just kind of sickened.
Well, I kept wondering, is this because it's the cartel and we really have to emphasize? This is the fucking cartel. These are guys who shoot up a kid's birthday party because they don't give a fuck.
they jump out the cake.
which, you know, and that's the thing. Like, I guess that's another thing that annoyed me was that he couldn't like stick to a look for the film because he kept jumping all over the place. You'd see lens flares out of nowhere to emphasize that this person is waking up from a daze, or and then the movie would turn into like the action scene you were describing, where they basically ambush the cartel. That becomes like it became a Michael Bay movie. And you could tell it became a Michael Bay movie because the audience got so into it. Whenever you see somebody get shot in the head, you hear somebody in the back go, fuck yeah, yeah, oh, watch out.
See, that's the duality of this movie. It's like there are certain scenes where they go so overboard with the action that you can't help but get into it. There was a black woman sitting behind us who about – this is her in the movie. Because Taylor Kitsch did something. Like, he's really good when he's real intense. Like, when he wants something, he's like, look, I don't give a fuck. Give me this girl back. I'm going to kill anybody who gets in my way. And he does get that look where he looks like he's taking a shit, you know, and got his nuts caught in something at the same time. And there was this black woman behind us who, for 5 minutes, she was like, woo-hoo-hoo, woo-hoo-hoo, woo-hoo-hoo. Did you hear her?
Oh, I heard her. I thought there was some cartel shit going on. I was like, is that the signal?
Around, it was an owl.
Woodsy back there going like, you just turn around and watch the movie.
I think somebody let a whooping crane fucking sit back here. Somebody sold a ticket. But that's the thing. When the movie works on that level, people eat it up. I mean, and that's why it. I think honestly, it has more in common sometimes with like Bad Boys 2 than anything.
Oh wow!
You're right. It does feel like a combination between a Michael Bay movie, a Tony Scott film, and an Oliver Stone film. Back when he did, I mean, look,
all had a baby.
If they all got together and
fucked Blake Lively,
if they fucked each other like these three characters are fucking,
and got into the most violent fucking orgy that you ever saw.
If they got together and did a human centipede,
Blake Lively is all. Stone, Taylor Kitsch is Tony Scott, and the other guy is.
If you sold Michael Oliver Bay. Stone's lips to Tony Scott's asshole, and then tied Tony Scott's asshole to
Michael Bay.
To Michael Bay's, to Tony Scott's lips, that's what you would get. No, listen, I'm going to get my rating here. It's one of those movies where I still can't decide on how I feel about it because it did make me feel so disgusting with the level of violence of this. But like I said, it's called Savages for a reason. And I have to warn you, they say Savages about 5 times in this movie where it's almost like you're supposed to stop and clap. They're like, because even at near the end of the movie, Blake Lively is like, the definition of savages is. I mean, really, you gonna give me the definition of the movie after I saw people cutting each other's heads off and shooting each other to death and doing all kind of gross ass shit? Yeah,
they must have had a hard time trying to think of a name for this movie. Yeah, that's all I thought.
You know, we should call this savages, but
like Ivy's pussy.
That's even savage. I bite the guy's dick off in the movie. No, I don't do that.
I thought you were gonna say that's sad when there's like I don't know how many sex scenes in here with Blake Lively without her getting naked.
What?
You see? Oh yeah. You see that's both the guys. Bullshit. You see both of the guys. Guys, perfectly round asses, fuck the shit out of her. But
what's this,
for a
motel porn?
Oh man, you know what? It's not just Blake Lively. Almost every chick who has to have sex. Now, a girl can walk by with a breast hanging all out, you know, a robe open. But if you're having sex, you have to have a gown or a flower dress on.
No.
And you cannot take. You can't even show any titties to your guy. Yeah. I don't know.
You can show a guy's eyeball hanging out. The fuck, America?
It's like what are we in Afghanistan?
In
what the
fact,
fuck?
That's bullshit.
When that guy's eyeball fell out, a titty popped out his eye socket. Wow, I get it here, but not in the sex scene. But no, it is a movie that I have to give credit for my feeling of confusion, because that feeling that I'm getting is because. I do get it. I mean, I do get it when they say, at what point, you might even like say this is a metaphor, as you were saying, Cyrus, for the war on drugs. At what point do the lines get blurred? At what point are we all implemented and sinking to a certain level in this so-called war? Who's corrupted? Who's going to a certain amount of violence? Who's dying that's innocent in the middle of this? I think that was all conveyed pretty well here. It was just in this really schizophrenic, fucking crazy-ass kaleidoscope package. And the action in it, when it kicks in, it's cool. In the ending of this movie, for some people, they're going to call it bullshit, but it was sort of a mind fuck to me, and I liked it. So I'm going to give this a low matinee. Got more things right than I thought it got wrong. But really, people, you have to realize what you get into. It is a bizarrely violent movie. It's not meant to make you feel good at all when you come out.
Well, it's funny, like the first 40 minutes of this movie, I hated it. I was not into it.
Oh, I can
at
tell.
All.
You got that face.
Wait, was he checking his watch?
Yes!
To be fair, I didn't even. The first time I checked my watch, it was an hour and 20 minutes into the film. So, no.
I think we all dread that fucking watch.
Yeah,
there, dude,
like,
when we go
like
to the movie. He's
gotten a handle on not going, but instead, it's checking the watch.
It was this long into the movie before this finally happened.
You substituted beer for the weed, and I actually, you know what? I think I prefer you on the.
You guys
the
can weed. Just not sit next to me if you want. It's up to you, since I'm the one always holding your fucking seat.
I like you better.
I like you better on weed, Cyrus. Y'all just sit somewhere else. It's okay.
It doesn't even annoy me. It's just you have things that. I mean, we all have things that we can count on with us, but you have yours, and you had them all. You even have the thing that you do where you looking to see if somebody's feeling like you do, because I remember I just went like, and you looking like to see if I, you yawning like me.
I'll tell you what,
we're brothers in this movie.
At Rocket Ages, I'm like, I'm getting the fuck out of here the moment Cyrus looks at that watch, because that's when it really, like, it's a punch in the face. And as soon as he fucking put that night glow shit on, I was gone. I really was.
Hey, I
you
stole
helped.
That from Leon, to be fair.
Yeah.
I only bought
Come
a
on,
watch
don't,
because
don't.
I was jealous of you checking it in the movies.
Yeah, he does. I ain't gonna lie. He does.
Don't even try to sit there and be all like, yeah, you do that.
And the greatest part is when you two have synchronized glows in the dark.
That's when you know it's time.
I always want to look at both of you guys and go, you guys ain't going fucking nowhere.
I'm sorry, Rock of Ages, you lost your privileges to do that.
You know, the thing is, like, ultimately, this did actually kind of win me back, even reconsidering the whole first 40 minutes or so. Once I said, I kind of enjoyed once I saw like what he was trying to do. I started actually having kind of fun with it, because I stopped caring as much about it as a regular narrative film and started looking at more of the other thing and what is Stone trying to say here. And wow, he's actually having a lot of fun saying it. I didn't feel like he was banging it over your head. He's trying to say, look, I want to say this, but I also want to make a movie with lots of shit blowing up and the sexy girls and lots of violence. I thought that element probably could have been done a lot better than he did do it, but you know, I mean, I had a good time with it more than I did, and I guess by the end. I mean, I laughed out loud. You know, we can't say, but there's a whole thing in the last 10 minutes that I think a lot of people are going to walk away from really pissed off about. But I thought it was fucking hysterical. I was like, oh, nice one. Nice joke on America, Oliver.
I'm with you on that. Yeah.
But it's still, there's so much that's wrong with this, too, that just didn't work. I'm going to go with you on a low matinee. I mean, I think that is ultimately what it is. Yeah. There's going to be people who are going to hate this movie to the point of being mad at us, though.
But Oliver Stone does.
Are you serious?
Man.
Oh yeah.
Because I don't think I honestly think they're gonna love it as far as like on like I said a level of Bad Boys 2, you know, where they're not going to notice all the things that we're noticing about it. I don't know. Like, it is one of those movies where I can give it points on the gratuitousness of the violence about it, where that keeps you locked in. It's like flipping through the TV. You don't care half the time, but when you see something like either cool or gross, you're like, you stop to watch and you just go, oh wow, that was cool. But then as it goes on, you're like, all right, I don't care again. And that's kind of how it was for me. I'm like you, Corey. I think it was it's kind of schizophrenic in its way. But the one thing that I will give it credit for is the performances, even though, you know, they don't really amount to much. But, you know, the Del Toro was just he was chewing up the scenery. And I really miss that guy. Watching him tonight made me realize how much I miss this guy, like playing characters like that, doing what he does best. And as far as like the violence of it, it's fun, it's stupid, but, you know, I can give it a pass, and I'm going to give it a matinee. It was stupid and fun. I'll probably forget about it. But the one thing, though, I will say, though, that ending, unlike you guys, I hated that. I always think that is like the worst thing as a writer you can do to an audience. You know?
And generally speaking, I would agree with you, like, more often than not. But once again, like I said, with that overlay of what he was trying to say, mm-hmm. then I liked it. Mm-hmm. I was like, oh, because I don't really care about these guys as real characters.
It's funny, Coase, because everything you've been saying about it had me thinking for sure you're going to give it a rental.
You know what? I'm still thinking about it. That's the thing. I'm still thinking about it. And I might end up watching it again, you know?
Yeah. I was reading up on this on Wikipedia like we usually do. There was something interesting here that Uma Thurman was supposed to play Blake Lively's mom.
In fact, I think they actually filmed those scenes. They were just cut out of the film.
Yeah, they rushed it. I just thought that was something that was interesting to talk about. And I got nothing to end on.
That's funny. Yeah. You're a savage.
I want to take a shower just because you dirty savages are making me feel really dirty.
Of my men dead?
I told you they'd come for me.
Stop.
Let me remind you that if I had to, I wouldn't have a problem cutting both their throats. There's something wrong with your love story, baby.
You let people think you're weak. Sooner or later, you're gonna have to